Today is a special Sunday, as mentioned. Later on at 1 p.m., some 38 of our brethren from the various congregations here will be entering the waters of baptism. And it is a day for us to rejoice, because all of them are declaring that in their life they have received Jesus and they have been changed and they have been born again. So it is a cause for celebration. One of them will be, or rather, many of them will be sharing their testimonies, and I've included excerpts of their testimonies in a separate sheet of paper that has been given to you. Usually we give out a newsletter, and beside that we also give this morning a sheet of paper containing the excerpts of the testimonies of our brethren. We want to share this with you so that you may be encouraged to also seek and find the Lord in your life, so that you may enter also into salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now I want to share with you one of them, alright? And it's written by a young man named Reuben, and this is what he wrote. He said, "Being born in a Christian family didn't make me a Christian, and it never will. Still, for the first 14 years of my life, I professed to know Jesus Christ as my Savior and claimed to be a Christian. I've never done drugs, I don't smoke, get drunk, or even drink alcohol. I have never committed murder or theft. But not having done any of these things, it still never made me a Christian, because I was never truly born again. Jesus said, 'Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God.'" That last statement made by Reuben is taken from a story of the Bible. This story depicts an encounter between the Lord Jesus Christ and a man named Nicodemus. And Jesus said to Nicodemus, "You must be born again." I think Nicodemus must be quite a senior man. Certainly not a man of my age. A man much older, I think, than myself. Yet Jesus said to this senior man, "Nicodemus, you need to be born again. You must be born again." And that's the same thing Reuben realized in his life. "I have grown up in a Christian family. My parents are Christians. I'm a churchgoer. But I was not born again." And Jesus says, "I must be born again." And so it is for myself. And I say, so it is for you. The story we are going to consider between Jesus and Nicodemus is not just a story for interest's sake. The sentence, the statement made by the Lord Jesus Christ is eternally true. You must be born again. So as we look at this story, this encounter between Jesus and Nicodemus, I hope you will not just be hearing about it, but you'll be saying to yourself, is this what God is speaking into my life? This is a message from God to you. You must be born again. You know, Nicodemus is a very interesting man. In fact, the Bible does tell us quite some details about his life. The Bible says in verse 1 of John chapter 3 that there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. He's quite an impressive man. He's, I think, the top dog of Israel in his time. The Bible says he's a ruler of the Jews. Now in those days, Israel was ruled by a group of people called the Sanhedrin. It's made up of some 70 wise, respected men. And they are the elders. They are the leaders of the nation. So 70 of them form the Sanhedrin. Nicodemus is one of the 70. He's a ruler of the Jews. So surely he's a man who has standing and stature. He's a man who is respected. He's a man who would be admired, a respectable man. The Bible does tell us also that Nicodemus is probably a rather wealthy man. Later on in the Bible, you read of him coming to embalm the body of Jesus with 100 pounds of spices. Now that's quite a weight to carry, but besides being heavy, it is also very costly. And it will take someone of quite great means to be able to purchase 100 pounds of spices, Nicodemus could. He's a rich man. In fact, tradition tells us that Nicodemus is probably one of the three richest men of Israel. So here is quite an impressive figure. A ruler of the Jews, a man who is rich. But besides that, he is a very religious man as well. He's religious. The Bible tells us he's a man of the Pharisees. The Pharisees are a group of religious people who set themselves apart from the world to practice their religion. They are a people who are very meticulous with the keeping of the law, the way they understand it. They set themselves apart to study the Bible, to study the scriptures. Ever since young, they'll be memorizing the Word of God. They'll be taking great care to practice it in their own lives. They will want to be separate from the world. They were a very religious people. And Nicodemus is a Pharisee. I don't think he's rich because he was involved in theft or in murder or things like that. He's a respectable man, rich man, and also a religious man. In fact, his name is quite revealing. His name Nicodemus means victor or conqueror. He's like the number one guy in Israel. So, if you think about achievements, accolades, status, standing, Nicodemus has it all. But Nicodemus had a niggling question in his heart. He had all these things, but he had unrest within his soul. The question he has in his life is this: will I go to heaven when I die? Will I have a relationship with God the way He wants? Am I really saved? What will happen to me after I die? No, Nicodemus, you have all these things. You are a good man, a religious man, probably a moral man. But Nicodemus, why do you think or feel that way? Well, Nicodemus knew deep within his heart that he is still man at best. He's still born a sinner. He knows that there is life after death. He knows that there is God. He knows that he will face judgment one day. And so this question of his heart is important to him. He needs to know, am I going to be saved? He wants to be sure. One day, Nicodemus heard about a man, a young man, 30 plus years old, who had gone around teaching the Bible in a way that has never been done before. He heard about this man performing miracles like it has never been done before. And straight away in his mind, he says, a prophet is now in Israel. For 400 years, Israel had not had a prophet from God. And so he says, I need to arise and meet this man named Jesus. Because he will show me and assure me whether I am saved. Am I on my way to eternal life, to heaven? And so he mustered sufficient courage, arose one day and went to search for Jesus. The Bible tells us in verse 2 that the same came to Jesus by night. I think you can understand why he would have to come at night. He doesn't want others to see him. He needs to come in the cover of darkness because after all, he is the ruler of the Jews. He's a teacher of Israel. And he wondered, how would others think when a ruler of the Jews would come to meet a 30 plus year old man who is known only as Jesus of Nazareth, who is born in the little town of Bethlehem, and who is a son of a poor carpenter? A man who has never been to Bible school, a man who has never been to theological seminary. How would others think? And so he said, I need to come to him, but let me come to him in a cover of darkness. And when he saw Jesus and met with him for the first time in his life, he said to Jesus these words, Rabbi, that is to mean teacher, master, Singaporean vernacular, Sifu, we know that you are a teacher come from God. For no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. He pays Jesus a sweet compliment. I think Nicodemus must have been thinking about this day for quite some time. And in his mind, the scenario would be rehearsed over and over again. He would imagine coming to Jesus and paying him a compliment. Coming from a ruler of the Jews, he might have thought that Jesus would have appreciated it and said, Nicodemus, thank you very much for your sweet compliment. And Nicodemus would say, but Jesus, can you tell me, am I on my way to heaven? Am I going to be saved? Am I a child of God? And he would have probably thought that Jesus would say, Nicodemus, you are a good boy. You have done well. You have achieved so much. You are a man of good standing. You are a ruler of the Jews. You have observed the laws the best you can. You deserve to go to heaven. You are a good candidate for salvation. You are just a little bit more that you need. You're just so close to heaven. Just a little bit more, Nicodemus. You are almost there. I think that must be the thinking of Nicodemus. Just a little bit more. Almost there. Well, all that must be in his mind. And so he started by paying Jesus a compliment. But look at verse 3. The Bible says, even before Nicodemus could ask any question, the Bible tells us, Jesus already saw the question in his heart. Jesus is God. He saw right through the heart of Nicodemus, and Jesus answered and said unto him, Nicodemus, verily, verily, or truly, truly, most assuredly, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. You know what? Nicodemus expected the words like, you are almost there. But Jesus says, you are nowhere near. You're not even close. But my whole life has been spent obeying God. My whole life has been seeking Him. From a child, I've studied the scriptures. Jesus says, you're nowhere near. You're not even close. You've got to start all over again. You've got to be born again. The Bible doesn't tell us how Nicodemus looked that day. But if I could, I wish I could have a camera that would focus on his face. I think his jaw would drop and his eyebrow would go right up to the hairline. He would be absolutely shocked. I mean, he came expecting some compliments from Jesus, saying, you are Nicodemus, you are victor, you are conqueror, you're the number one top dog in Israel. You must be the one who will be saved. But Jesus says, you are nothing. You're nowhere close. You've got to be born again. Are you sure, Jesus? Yes. Verse 5. He repeats almost the same thing. Except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. So Jesus is saying, in your life right now, if you die right now, you cannot see, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. You are not fit for the kingdom.